the colloquium talk this afternoon. He is professor at School of Art and Aesthetics, JNU, and distinguished theater critic. His talk is entitled Reflections on the Broom, and as the abstract has already mentioned, it draws from his book, Rajasthan in Oral History, Conversations with Komal Kothari, and a documentary film made by
Navroze Contractor,
who I'm happy to note is with us this afternoon. So Rustom will speak first and then show excerpts from the documentary, followed by a Q&A. Rustom.
Thank you. Should I speak like this? I don't need a mic. Okay. I have a bit of sciatica, so if my legs feel really painful, I'm going to sit. It's a great pleasure to be here. And many thanks to you, Chandan, for a two-year correspondence, practically, where we've been trying to work out the dates, and it has proved to be difficult. I realize coming from Delhi to Bangalore as such is no big deal. Maybe coming from one part of Bangalore to another part of Bangalore is harder. So I'm very grateful to you for those of you coming long distances for this talk. And it's just a talk. It's not a formal lecture. And I think the talk might be, please come and sit here if you can find a seat, because it's primarily a talk. We're not going to show. Made by Navroze Contractor. I'm very happy he's here. It's not the whole film. It's just a few sections. So I'm going to reflect, think aloud on material culture, caste, development. Now, these are very, very weighty categories embedded in the social sciences. And I am no social scientist. So maybe you have a right and a very reasonable question could be, say, well, what gives you the right and what entitles you to speak about material culture, caste, and development? And I'll be very honest and say the only way in which I can find myself beginning to reflect on it is through the mediation of one of the most ordinary, inconspicuous, most seemingly worthless of all objects that nobody ever really thinks about, and that is the broom, the jharu. The next question you might ask me is, well, how did you get so involved with brooms? How did you start thinking about brooms if they're so worthless and inconspicuous? It's a very good question. So the first qualification that needs to be made is I'm not making a pitch here for the Aam Aadmi Party. We know that the Aam Aadmi Party has the broom, the jharu, as its political symbol. I'm very curious to know how they arrived at it. My little knowledge of the broom goes back many, many years earlier, before the Aam Aadmi Party was in existence, and before any of them were probably even thinking about brooms. And it goes back to one man called Komal Kothari. Without him, I wouldn't be here talking to you in the first place. Who is this Komal Kothari, for those of you, how many of you have heard that name? Very few. It's a sad reflection, and well, that's how history works in India. Komal Kothari was in some ways unclassifiable. He was not an academic, but he was based in Jodhpur. There's no academic in the world who would have dared to write about Jodhpur or Rajasthan without, in a sense, talking to him, consulting him, because he had this prodigious knowledge of life in the desert regions of Rajasthan. Predominantly a knowledge about material culture, land, water, irrigation, livestock, Babuji, Sati, Teratali, Langas, Mangadiya, I mean, there was a huge spectrum. And, you know, I was very privileged to get to know him towards the last years of his life, where I just talked to him. He was a prodigious talker, could have been in the Guinness Book of Records, I'm sure. Talk for 8-10 hours on end, literally, you wouldn't feel it. He'd just hold you. And out of that 3-year conversation emerged a book called Rajasthan and Oral History, Conversations with Komal Kothari. That's him right here. He's the subject of the book. So after the book was done, and he was, I'm very happy to say, alive to see it published, he had a few years to live. He had a dream. And he was very, very clear. He wanted to make a museum. I thought that was very impractical because he was a very unsystematic man. He never organized anything. I said, how can he make a museum? He wanted an ethnographic museum. That's even worse. Because an ethnographic museum, for any of you with some knowledge of anthropology, would know ethnography and ethnographic museums are steeped in the worst kinds of essentializations, exoticizations of primitive peoples. So I said, what's he doing? But there was one thing he was very clear about, absolutely clear. And he said, this museum will begin with one object, only one, the broom. In the beginning, nobody took it seriously. They thought some folkloric nonsense. And I have to tell you, it took me 3 years after he passed away. And after a year, I became a project director of a museum that came to be known as Arna Jharna, the Desert Museum of Rajasthan. Arna Jharna, in this deserted part of Rajasthan, there's no Arna, there's no Jharna, it's just abandoned mines, harsh territory, animal dumping sites, abattoirs, no beauty there. And that's where we built the museum. So, let me drink. Working there, and it took about 3 years to get the museum going, I realized the broom was a stroke of genius. And I don't use that word too often. Because something so ordinary, so utterly inconsequential. How many of you even use a jharu? We get people to use jharus for us. Do you look at it? Do you see it? Do you touch it? Do you engage with it? And then I realized after 3 years, it covers everything. Pollution, purity. It can be worshipped as the goddess Lakshmi. It is also the very embodiment of the stigma of untouchability, right? It can be used as a healing device. There's this practice called jhara, where you can remove all kinds of skin diseases or whatever. So it can heal. It's also the very repository of disease, okay? It can be a symbol of protest. Long before Aam Aadmi Party, I mean this, I've seen photographic evidence of Dalit rallies, I think in Andhra, where the entire, you know, crowd is holding a jharu in their hands, you know? So it can be a weapon, okay? You can beat, and it's also the most abject, the most humble of all objects that doesn't want to be seen. Chupkar, it's hidden somewhere. So when you ask me, you know, what's in a broom? I would say the world. The world is in the broom. And that's what sort of came alive. In the third year of the project, we made with Navroze Contractor, veteran documentary filmmaker, a friend of Rupayan Sansthan, the organization that, in a sense, under whose aegis the museum was produced. Well, a film was made. A film called Jhadu Katha. And it's simply, it's not about the museum. I decided that would be a completely different film to make, and I didn't think that was that important. What was important was to really hear the voices of broom makers and broom users, who were our source, right? And out of which, in a sense, the museum came into being. And now we felt, let's get back to the source again and see what's really happening at ground levels. So that's the trajectory. That's how the broom enters my world, and that's why I'm talking to you about this. This book is called An Oral History, and orality is perhaps the link between these two projects, the book and the film, but there are different modes of orality, okay? I want to reflect on this a little bit. So the methodology of how you arrive at concepts has to be taken very seriously. Concepts are not just givens. I think that's what goes wrong a lot with social sciences, that we get our definitions. You begin with histories of development, but when you don't have those givens, then you have to figure out, how the hell do I figure it out? What is this thing called development or material culture? So, history. Many people say, well, how can you call it history? He's no historian, you're no historian. And I say, I don't know what else I could have called it. I couldn't have called it Stories and Legends of Rajasthan. You know, for the simple reason, I was not writing a coffee table book, of course, but he was not a storyteller. I mean, if we are going to use the word story in the sense of fiction, something made up, no storyteller. He was not really very good at remembering stories, okay? I couldn't have called it Songs and Ballads of Rajasthan, because contrary to the fact that without Komal Kothari, there would be no category today called Rajasthani folk music. Komal Da's entry into this field was through music, okay? Although he was not a musicologist, but that was his real knowledge, came from music. But, and over the years, he, well, this is historical facts, that groups like the Langas and the Manganiars were scattered. They didn't have a repertoire. They just sang songs for themselves for different purposes. Over the years, he created a repertoire, and today the Langas and the Manganiars are among the most globalized of all performers in the Indian folk sector, which comes with its own problems. We can talk about that later, huge problems. Okay, so he has this background in music. He never sang a song for me. Never. It would have been weird if he had sung for me. You know, he was not a singer. So I couldn't have called it Songs of Rajasthan. What then was he talking to me about? He was talking to me about everyday life. How people live in the desert regions of Rajasthan, how they survive the harsh conditions of their life. He was talking to me about what we would today call everyday cultural practices. The cultures of everyday life. It is the history of the everyday. Okay? And then I said, yeah, I'm going to go and call this a history. I think that's what he's telling me. But it's a history of, not of kings and queens and dynasties and all of that stuff, but just everyday life, cooking, eating, plowing a field, digging a well, etc., etc. So we were not dealing with historiography. We were not dealing with the history of history. That's what historiography is. The written documents on history, the archival inputs on history, interpretations of history, not at all. In our three-year conversation, he never once discussed a book. It's not that he hadn't read books. He had great friends among scholars. That was not our conversation. The knowledge he was giving me, of course, I'm not trying to say that orality can exist without the written, and we know that Ramanujan has problematized that very deeply, but in our conversation, no books, no historiography. There was no historicity in the sense of the evolution of a concept or phenomenon over a period of time. Why? Because as he put it to me very candidly, I don't think in time. I'll get to that next. And he was not dealing with what Ronajit Guha has called historicality. In his wonderful book, History at the Limit of World History, which ends with Rabindranath Tagore. This is the doyen of subaltern studies who ultimately turns to Tagore, and he's saying it's a poet's history that we have to think about. And what is this poet's history? It's about being in the world. Now, that would be too abstract for Komala. Being in the world, no, I don't understand being. He was a nuts and bolts kind of man. So I stick to history. But I call it an oral history because it was spoken to me, okay? That doesn't mean an oral history doesn't get written, otherwise there wouldn't be a book. So the dynamic between the written and the spoken is huge. Now, let me get back to what I just said when he said, I don't think in time. It wasn't a philosophical statement as it's appearing to be. I asked him a question and he looked puzzled and he said, I don't think in time. I think in, and he went like this. Yes, went like this. And of course you might say, is he saying space? I don't think in time, I think in space. Maybe too fancy, too theoretical. If I had to interpret what that gesture was, I would say that what Komalda was really doing, he was saying, I think through interconnected contexts and practices of knowledge. So the key word for him, for me, and for what I got was interconnectedness. That's what mattered. It was not studying just irrigation, just agriculture, just livestock, like people had done in the people's science and technology movement. Very technical. No, his mind would immediately move to something else. That was in him. That was that was the grammar of his thinking. So for example, if he'll talk about Jogya Sarangi, a particular instrument, then he say, you know, Jogya Sarangi is always to be found in the Sevan grass growing area. That Sevan grass growing area, which you will find in the Bajra staple food category region. In such and such season where, you know, the rainfall will be between 2 to 3 inches, etc., the grass can go to 6 feet high and camels can disappear as they pass through them. In this region, you will find such and such epic tradition sung, etc., etc. It would just, you know, just go like that. And he would take you, and then come back. Now, Ramanujan had asked that wonderful, is there an Indian way of thinking? We've been talking about the Indianization of the curriculum. And I don't know if this was an Indian way of thinking, but I certainly had never encountered this kind of crystalline, clear, but labyrinthine kind of thinking. Today, if you're using fancy postmodern jargon, it would be called rhizomatic. It's rhizomatic, it's moving like this, you know? It's not moving like here, going downwards. It's going through networks, another kind of, you know, catchword of our times. He wasn't using those words, but that's how his mind was thinking. So that was very, very important to keep in mind. So, what are things doing, you know? So for example, you could say, what does a well do? It provides you with water. What does a pump do? It does this. What does this do? What is for, you know? But what does a poem do? What does a song do? What does a dance do? Not what does a song express. And of course, in that crucial juxtaposition between expressing and doing, we have entered the language of what today is called performativity. You know, what is the performance? What is it actually putting into practice? What is it affecting? Now, I'll give you an example so it becomes a little more clear. We were talking about cattle, and he was talking about different breeds of cattle. And of course, he would tuck in little amazing things like, there are people who are experts in reading the hoof prints of cattle. They can, from these prints of the pug marks of cattle, they can figure out how many cattle belong into this one particular region anyway. Then we again talked about cattle fairs. We talked about how if you have a cattle fair, you need water sources, etc. And then he suddenly brought in Hir Ranjha. Hir Ranjha came into the cell. Now, Ranja probably because buffalo keeper, very tenuous link. And I thought to myself, oh, great, finally, a text, narrative. You know, finally, I don't have to hear about cow dung or animal dung. I'll hear a poem, the great poem of Hir Ranja, which has been made into films and, you know, Parsi theater and all of that stuff. He says one line, Hir Ranja, it's a great poem. Next line. Hir Ranja is about foot and mouth disease. And you say, oh? And then you say, yes. And then very painstakingly, very calm, you say, you see, in cattle epidemics, people don't move. They stay put. They stay in one place. And the cattle don't move. That's very important. They have to be penned. And during that time, people resort to all kinds of indigenous quarantine practices. Alum and water, no particular foods not made, etc. And during that time, they listen to Hir Ranja at night. All night performances of Hir Ranja. You know, people thought he was weird. When he went to Pakistan, he wanted to find out if that was the same practice. People laughed at him. They said, you're mad, who would... He tracked those people down. They said, yes, we sing Hir Ranja. But a different version of Hir Ranja. Now, this is where there are complexities. Now, if I position myself in relation to this detail, how would I interpret it? I think it's very difficult for me, as a modern person who didn't grow up with all this, it's very difficult for me not to read some kind of a value in it. You know, it's very difficult. Because I know in today's world, when there's so many all kinds of these diseases spreading, cattle disease, whatever, what do people do? What do people in the enlightened world do? They burn the cattle. Hundreds of cows, hundreds of people are burned alive. Can you imagine? What do we do when there's bird flu? In the Northeast, I read this. They don't kill the birds. They bury them alive. Because if you kill them, of course, you run the risk of contamination through blood. So we are protecting ourselves. But it's okay to smother them in mud and suffocate them to death. Now, if that isn't brutal, I don't know what is, you know. Now, from this kind of interpretation, you might say that I'm some kind of an anti-modernist, which I'm not. I'm just pointing out the brutality of certain modernizing mechanisms. It's very easy to take this kind of detail and do what, let's say, an Ashish Nandi would do with it, and perhaps a Shiv Vishwanathan, where they will go into this kind of, you know, ethos of a certain traditional knowledge system that doesn't partake of the violence of modernity, etc. This is not Komal's tack at all. He was not interested in the evaluation of this fact. He was certainly no anti-modernist. Not interested in... He was the least judgmental person I've ever met. And I'm a very polemical person. So for me, it was quite an education to just be with somebody who said, it's not that facts are not interpretations if you went to pursue the postmodern line. But he didn't take that path, okay? So, no anti-modernist stance. Because he was only too aware that what we call the folk, the so-called folk, is part of modern life. They're not some curiosities in a museum. These are people who are living, as we are living, but in very different conditions in different parts of India. And in this context, the key principle for me, for the museum, and for understanding the broom, I will say, it simply can be encapsulated in a few words. The folk is contemporary. The folk is of our times. It's not something that has to be studied then. It has to be studied now, with all the contradictions that we live with. And in that sense, I come to the broom. The broom is profoundly contemporary. We're not talking about witches and broomsticks. Not at all. That doesn't figure even at the level of folklore in India. So it's contemporary. And that's why I'm able to talk about material culture, caste, and development. Otherwise, it wouldn't be possible to do so. Now, when we started off the project on the museum, there was already some preliminary kind of, facts. Very rudimentary. And I want to share those with you. We began, of course, with the materiality of the broom. And the materiality of the broom, I think, would have to be studied at two levels. One, in terms of the natural resources that constitute it, and also the labor that goes into it. So those are the two kinds of areas that one can pick up on. In terms of natural resources, brooms are made out of any number of natural resources. Any number of grasses, shrubs, fibers of different kinds, reeds, date palm, khajur, coconut. The full jharu, for example, which is used all over India, that's the most ubiquitous of brooms. Where does that come from? Where does that material come from? Just two states, Meghalaya from India. That's the place where that reed is to be found, you know. And that reed does not grow in Rajasthan, but there's a big full jharu kind of industry in Rajasthan. So when this reed comes to Rajasthan in trucks, think of the migration now of all these things, you know, the raw material being, in a sense, moved from one point to another point. It's very interesting. Little details struck me as revelatory, that the material actually shrinks along the way. So if you take this much of reeds, probably by the time it gets to Jodhpur, it's shrunk a bit. And this is something, and what does it make you realize? It makes you realize there's life in it. It's organic. You know, it's not dead, you know. And I think that for me was that we're not dealing with dead things, just materials that can be just made into something. There's something that had to be respected about that life, and that's where just taking a blade of grass, and all of this becomes clearer in the film. Just take a blade of grass. What do I see? A blade of grass. But in that blade of grass, there are four parts. There is the sarkanda, there's the inner stem, there's the munj, there's the outer layer, there's the sirki, the flowering tendrils, and there's the panni, the blade itself. And different kinds of brooms are made out of each of those parts. So you can imagine the kind of minute botanical kind of knowledge that is available and the extreme delicacy with which all these things can be removed. It's a very, very organic relationship. Very different in this regard from the only non-organic substance that we have for brooms, and that's plastic, which has entered the market in a very big way. But good news, plastic is not really going to work. Why? Because plastic and dust don't have a very good relationship, you know? Since we live with an omnipresence of dust in India, plastic is a loser, you know? Plastic will only work in the metropolitan bathroom, you know, on tiles, you know, where you, after your shower or whatever, you can remove the water. It's effective, I think very effective. As one very socialite woman who was very amused I was working on brooms said, I like the plastic broom. I said, why? She said, because you can wash it, you know. You can clean the broom, you know. It's just the opposite of the broom has to clean this. No, I want to clean the broom, so it always looks fresh and smart. Okay, different mentality. Labor. Millions of brooms are made in India every year. I'm sorry you are from social sciences. I should be able to come up with statistics. Very hard to come up with. But let's say if you do a rough average count in your, how many brooms would you have in your own house? Two? How many do you have? Four. You have four. On an average, nothing less than three. In rural areas, five. Because you have the cow pen or the animal pen, that's one broom. There's a courtyard, that's another broom. There's the inner house, that's a different broom. Yes, the kitchen washing area will be a very different broom. If you go to Bengal, they've got a broom even, or a kind of broom for the bed, you know, chuck, chuck, you know, all these things. And then, of course, you have little brushes and brooms. We are a little flexible in our cat, you know. Yes, the little puja broom, exactly. You see, you all are so informed. This is the number of brooms. Now, if you say 3 to 5, just calculate the number of people in this room and think of the household, and you have to have a turnover in the course of the year. At least 3 brooms have to be changed. Just think. If you do a rough calculation, we're talking millions, probably billions of brooms are made in India. It's so big, you can't even begin to imagine. And guess what? Almost all of them continue to be made by hand. There are implements, there are tools like, you know, threshing, very primitive things. It could just be a plank of wood with nails, and you just, you know, beat again. You see all that in the film. So, you know, it's made by hand. So where's the machine? The body. The body becomes the machine. The body is the technology, provides the technology of the broom. And you see that in the film, in the opening sequence, where every limb of the body, from the toe to the teeth, are involved in the making of the broom, for most brooms. And at one level, it's very ergonomic. It's very, very, you know, economic, because you have to turn out 100 brooms a day. So you've got to work very fast, and, you know, with all everything in place, it's like a very good housewife who knows how to cook very fast. This is here, that is here, you put this here, you change this there. It's just fast. So on one level, it's that. That's a good side, but it's also backbreaking. It's hard work. And let's face it, it disfigures you. It's very, very harsh on the body, especially the teeth, and particularly harsh for young women who may lose their teeth because you use the teeth as a lever, you know. So there's that side. Can you change this in terms of development? Can you really come up with other technologies and tell them, why are you using your teeth? Why don't you use this? Or what? Very hard to shift this. And this is where perhaps Pierre Bourdieu's concept of the habitus needs to be, because the habitus is something so deeply embedded, you know. It's very, very, it becomes your second nature. It's very hard to change that, you know. So it's a harsh reality that we're really dealing with here. Yeah, there was one point I wanted to say. What do you think is the prototype of the broom in terms of the human body? Think. What do you think? Yes, indeed. Because the hand has these 5 fingers, and this can be used for all kinds of cleaning purposes. And it's a very, very harsh, degrading reality. And this is where the whole subject becomes very, very difficult and painful. And that when you actually see scavengers and you actually see people cleaning clogged drains, no implement will work in some situations. No improvised implement, no little, you know, we all create our little implements to, you know, unblock a drain or whatever. It doesn't work. Ultimately, it is the hand. And when I saw that with my eyes, I said, oh my God, you know, what are we really dealing with? Okay. When we started off with materiality, there was a correlation, very rudimentary correlation made between materiality and caste. Because all resources are linked with particular caste groups who have an entitlement to use that particular material. Now, this can be very complicated, and it indeed became complicated in the course of our research. What did we begin with? From empirical evidence. One, grass brooms, panni brooms, were being used predominantly by the Banjara community. Now, Banjara is a very large community, nomadic, but splintered, dislocated, settled. So we were dealing with a settled Banjara community in Jodhpur, working exclusively with the poor man's broom, the 5 rupee broom, the panni broom, 100 brooms a day to just put food into your stomach for a family. That was the correlation. The khajur broom, which is very big, not so much in cities but in rural areas, was exclusively identified when we began the research with a community we called Koli. Now, I had heard of Koli in relation to Maharashtra, the fishing community. There's no connection. This Koli community, we then realized, was actually a kind of name for a much larger caste group that is identified as Bargunda. The Bargunda community is very wide, very widespread, very entrepreneurial, still working with Khajur, but moving more and more into full Jharu because the market is there. Now, I want to stop a little bit here and talk about how intricate caste names are. So we began identifying with a Koli community. Now, where is this Koli community from? We thought from Andhra Pradesh. A migrant community has come from Andhra Pradesh via Mandor in Madhya Pradesh into Jodhpur. How do we arrive at this without any great evidence? Well, the fact that though they speak Hindi and Marwari, they count all their numbers in Telugu. That doesn't leave them. So that's one of the most mnemonic things. You find even very big corporate people suddenly going, you know, like this, you know, like they're dealing with trillions and they're counting the trillions and the notches in their fingers. You know, these are very mnemonic things. They're part of your body memory. You can't actually let go of them. No amount of gentrification will change certain habits. And when we moved into other places, they were also called Verma. And there were, of course, what is a big influence here is reservation categories. So different groups get identified by different names in different states and even within the same state for all kinds of reservation-related reasons. Komalda was a master at understanding the nomenclature of caste. Very, very intimate understanding of this. I'll give you one example. We were working on Pabuji Kipar, and the chief figure over there was Parbu Bhopa, who was the partner and informant, if you will, of John Smith, who has written the definitive book on the epic of Pabuji. Very regal man, very dignified man. He approved of the book, etc. But he said there's one problem with the book. Why has he referred to me as Nayak? This is creating problems for me. I am a Bhil, you know? And then Komalda, only Komalda could make these, negotiate these very gently. He said, but you know, when I came to your village in such and such year, in early 1960, you were not Bhil, you were not Nayak, you were Thori, which is a derogatory caste category today. So caste categories operate at many, many different registers, and they are multiple sometimes. He told me another very, very harsh, it's in my book, of a community called Pavia. He had encountered the Pavia in one part of Rajasthan, and they were associated with some kind of recitation tradition. And then when he traveled southwards in another time of the year, he saw them again. He recognized the community. But this time they were working as bone collectors. That's the most degraded of all kinds of, to collect bones or to work with animals, skins, you know. And they were living what we may say incognito. They were living in silence. You know, and so there are these dual identities, and he was aware of these things. Okay, to get back to caste and material, the bamboo broom is monopolized entirely by the self-identified, and I stress self-identified, Harijan community who call themselves Harijan in Rajasthan. Now, these are important qualifications to make within our existing, the Dalitization of Indian society. And it poses certain challenges, methodological challenges. How do you name people, you know, when you think a category is politically incorrect? But if they name themselves in that way, do you have a right to change that category? And my view on that is very simple, and I go, if I wish to be identified in a certain way, if I want to call myself black, you know, identifying myself, let's say, with the black movement or whatever, I would want that to be respected, you know? So in Rajasthan, we are dealing with a very feudal state. Caste identities are very deeply entrenched. No way you can deny this. And this Harijan community works exclusively with the bamboo broom. What makes them very different is not just their monopoly over the bamboo broom, which is the most expensive of brooms. The bamboo broom is a solid kind of broom. It lasts a longer time, nothing less than 60 or 70 rupees today. We're talking a big one, solid ones, with metal and, you know, around the edges. So, not only do they make the broom, this is the difference, they use the broom professionally because they are employed as municipal sweepers. Average salary, 8,000 rupees. Okay. Now, if we pull out of this and we try and take a broader economic take on all of this, what do we get? Is there a correlation between caste and social mobility through livelihood, through growing income? Can we make any direct kinds of parallels? And the answer is no. Because the Harijan community, if you did a statistical analysis, would probably be earning more than any of the broom communities that we've seen in Rajasthan. But the social stigma that they face is the deepest. So your social status is not likely to change, even though you may be earning more money. And the fact is that even though there are many positions available for municipal sweepers in the Jodhpur municipality, there are no takers for the jobs. Nobody wants to do that work because it's so degrading and so harsh. Okay? So that's the reality. Conversely, what we found when we went into the field, and this was the power of the documentation, the film taught us many things that we didn't know. The biggest community, the most widespread community, is the community called Bagaria or Bagri. And they are the most disorganized, the most, there's no kind of system. Like, the Harijans have their organizations. There is reservation politics and there is mobilization of a certain kind. Bagarias have nothing. There's no ekta, as one of the say, in the community. It's broken. The community is diffused. They're on the streets. They're vagrants. They're living from hand to mouth. Now, what is their caste status? They're OBC. So the most kind of wretched are put in this terrible bind because within that caste category, they are not entitled to buy land from, quote, low caste groups. They can only buy it from the upper caste groups and they can't afford it. So they're stuck. So their situation is, in a sense, the most desperate that was encountered in the entire film. So what was the difference between writing the book and making and being involved in the making of the film? I was not directly involved in the actual shoot of the film. There was a different team for that led by Navroze. But I watched some of the editing and I prepared a sequence of how there could be a logic in the enormous material that was gathered. I would focus on what, Indira, you had once told me that you'd wanted me to focus a bit on listening. If I had any role to play in the writing of the book, I would ask somebody, I did a workshop with you on oral history, I would begin with listening. Because oral history is not something that is coming out of a person's mouth. It is also about somebody who is taking it in. And if that somebody is not there, there's no history, actually. It's like music, it's like a performance. If you're singing, of course you can sing for yourself in the bathroom, in the toilet, and you can think you're great, but you know, if you really want something to happen, somebody has to listen to your song. And I never realized this till I began to hear the recordings over and over and over. So I was listening not only to Komalda live, I was listening to Komalda recorded over and over and over and over and over and over again. And that's what performance is. Performance is about repetition. That's basically what goes into performance, and that's something I know. Now, when I was listening to the tapes, of course, it was very funny because all I was hearing on my voice was, It's just this nonverbal hum, which is absolutely, you might say, inconsequential. But when I would tell Komalda with some exasperation at times, I said, if I'm not here, why don't you just turn on the tape recorder and, you know, just record what you have to say? He says, it doesn't work. Which made me feel quite happy because I said, at least I have a role to play. And the listener's role is crucial. Because the listener is actually in some way shaping that entire narrative. And not just accompanying it or, you know. And he was giving me, I now realize, what I was prepared to listen to at a certain point in time, for which I had implicitly prepared a frame for what we needed to listen together. So there's an incredible complicity that takes place between listener and speaker. The other thing I know from my theater experience is that you never just listen with your ears. You listen with your body. You have to listen with your complete body. So that I have a mnemonic recall not just of the voice, but what he was doing with his body, even if it was a very minimal gesture. And listening is active, fully participatory. It's not a passive couch potato type of thing. You know, no, it's interpretive in its own way. And so all these things. Now, the crucial question, I can't go into everything. When you listen to someone, and then you write it down, there's no direct transference. I mean, that should be pretty obvious. Between the listening and the writing, there are at least in this book 8 drafts. And it's when you look at the writing, it's very, very simple, but that was a hard thing to get. So what is being written grammatically, because you have to work within grammar, the grammar of the voice and the grammar of the written word are two totally different things. And that's something that is a skill that you have to just keep working at. Navroze is here. He can talk more about documentary, since that he's a veteran in that field. But in my limited exposure to what I saw, I found the editing process in making of the film amazing. I mean, I was just stunned by the minute details that had to be. It was such a technical process for me. See, when I edit, we all edit. We edit for all kinds of reasons, clarity, cover-ups, you know, trying to find strategic links with notes, et cetera, et cetera. It's a cognitive process predominantly for me. And then you get rhythm and things, but it's cognitive. But when you're working in the film, on the one hand, the voice is coming out of the mouth is speaking, so there's no kind of, you don't think there's a transference, but yes, of course there is a transference because that voice is being recorded, you know. And when you get into real editing, when you've got a 3-hour interview or whatever and you're making it 8 minutes, woo, that's where the skill of the film comes through, and that's what it is when you see it. It's very simple on the surface, but it's a lot of hard work that goes into getting that 8 minutes, you know, to flow. And there, it's not just the cognition, it's also lighting, pitch, sound, things that you wouldn't believe. The face is in this angle, it's not in this angle, and all of those things. It's quite a challenge. So basically, it was this act of listening that connects the two things for me together. I think I've talked enough. Maybe we can see a bit of the film, and then we can throw, maybe I'd like to show maybe 2 excerpts, and haven't talked about development sufficiently. Just to say it's a big business. As one of our, we have two interviews, very colorful interviews, I wish you could hear them. One of them says it's a bit like the Bombay underworld. Just as the Bombay underworld has divided all of, you know, the film industry, the broom industry also is sort of divided by a few families. It seems to be symbolic of the national economy at large, isn't it? You know, the few families carving up everything. Anyway, so the man said something to that effect. He stressed regional particularities. That it's a wonderful line from the film. Only comes with such confidence. If a woman from Kota buys a Kota broom from, she will never use any other broom from any other part of the world. She will only buy the Kota broom. And it's this kind of a conviction that that regional particularity is something no multinational will ever be able to understand. That is actually one of the strong points in the argument. No multinational will capture the market. This is a cottage industries, you know, and because it's not taxed, that's interesting to keep in mind. So parts of the broom, all the plastic is taxed and this and that, but not the broom itself is still not taxed. People are making money out of it, and people are also surviving and, well, toiling and enduring very hard lives. So it's a big contradictory, big business kind of situation. So let's see the opening of the film. And could we start the opening? And just to introduce it, it's we show you just an interview with Gopal Banjara, who's making the Panni broom, and his family. And this will be followed by three interviews with women, rural women from three different caste groups in rural Rajasthan, and who have very different positions on, well, the symbolic role of the broom. Sort of the market economy through exchange value, but there are a lot of brooms that are never made to be bought or sold. They're just made to be used. So the women are talking about brooms that they have made themselves and which they use for their own purposes. So it's, and many of our brooms in our museum have those beautiful brooms with us. Sound. Thank you.
उपस्थिति हमारे समाज में ये समझो कि 70-80 साल से ही बसी हुई है। पहले हम नहीं थे यहाँ पे, हम तो क्या है कि एक साल कहीं, छः महीने कहीं, दो साल कहीं, ऐसे घुमक्कड़ जाते थे। उत्तर प्रदेश से ही माल आता है, और जैसे अलवर जिला है, हरियाणा है, पंजाब की साइड में बरसात अच्छी पड़ती है तो वहाँ माल ये होता है दूध का, वहाँ से लेके आते हैं। राजस्थान में तो बिल्कुल ही नहीं होता, जैसे कि आपके बरसात हुई है तो आपके थोड़ा बहुत माल होगा, वो भी मतलब राजस्थान को मतलब पूर्ति नहीं कर सकता, फिर भी माल तो उत्तर प्रदेश से लाना पड़ेगा। क्या कि जंगल लेते हैं, उसकी कटाई करते हैं, कटाई करके फिर इसको सुखाते हैं, सुखा के फिर इसके वापस भरोटे बांध के और फिर हम ले जाते हैं। कई वैरायटी होती है। अब ये माल है, ये माल इस टाइम 8 रुपये किलो का है, बहुत महंगा ही है। और ये माल है, ये 20 रुपये किलो का है। और एक इससे भी हल्का माल होता है, वो 3 रुपये किलो का होता है। अलग अलग वैरायटी होती है इसमें। अच्छा, अब हम जो 20 रुपये किलो वाले को लेंगे, इसमें हमारे को कोई ज़्यादा वो नहीं, मेहनत मजदूरी नहीं मिलेगी, पूरे दिन खपेंगे तो हम 8 आदमी हैं, 8 आदमियों के हमारे 200 रुपये की मजदूरी होगी। हमने ना तो स्कूल का मुँह देखा है, हम तो मतलब जन्मे हैं और ये बदलपुरी का मोटा आदमी लेंगे। ये ले लिया बस, चलो काम पे, कोई 5 रुपये का कर रहा है, कोई 2 रुपये का कर रहा है, कोई 5 रुपये का कर रहा है, कोई 3 रुपये का कर रहा है, कोई 8 आने का कर रहा है, अब ये बच्चा है 8 आने का करता है। 6 लड़कियां हैं, 2 लड़के, तो पहले हम तो पानी को भी तोड़ के पीने वाले हैं, जाति से हैं कि 100 रुपये का खर्चा मत करो, उसमें से 95 रुपये का ही खर्चा करो। आप 200 रुपये कमा रहे हैं तो हम 5 रुपये रोजाना के अलग से कर रहे हैं। अब मैं भी चाहता हूँ कि मेरे कोई बंगला बना लूँ मात्र का, पर वोट करने से और थोड़ी होती है, वो तो कुछ ना कुछ दबड़ी है तो चमड़ी चलेगी। तो अब आमदनी नहीं है तो क्या करें, हम मरते कहाँ जाए, दूसरा कोई वो है नहीं हमारे पास जरिया, कोई गड्ढिया किसी से 5,000 ले रखे हैं, किसी से 10,000 ले रखे हैं, किसी से 500 ले रखे हैं, किसी से 20,000 ले रखे हैं, तो धीरे 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 उतारूंगा, कहीं से 100 ले आता हूँ, कहीं से 200 ले आता हूँ, कहीं से 500 ले आता हूँ, कहीं कहीं मेरे उस्ताद ऐसे मिल जाते हैं तो वो पॉकेट में ही निकाल देते हैं। रात को भी गया था मैं भजन गाने के लिए, 15-18 दिन तक मतलब उनके घर भजन गाए और उन्होंने बस एक सिर के ऊपर तिलक खींच दिया कि धन्यवाद। पहले 12 ग्रामते थे तो गाड़ी मोटर वाले लगे, और फिर सोई कंगी बेचने लगे, लकड़ी की कंगी लाते थे कहीं से बनी हुई बेचते थे, तो ये प्लास्टिक वाले कंगी वाले लगे पीछे, हमारे समाज के तो पीछे लगे। और अब हम इस काम को झाड़ू बनाने के लिए लगे, सड़की बनाने के लिए लगे, सड़की बनाते हैं तो बस होगी चटाई निकाल दी पैसे वालों ने, प्लास्टिक के निकाल दिए, कोई कैसा निकाल दिया, कोई कैसा निकाल, हमारे समाज के गरीबों के तो पीछे लगे हुए हैं। इसमें मेहनत 10 गुना है, हमारे हाथ से काम हो रहा है, वो एक ही मशीन 10,000 झाड़ू एक दिन में बना देगी, और मेरा परिवार क्या, मेरी पूरी कॉलोनी पूरे दिन के अंदर 2,000 झाड़ू नहीं बना सकते, बल्कि 2,000 क्या 1,000 झाड़ू नहीं बन सकते, क्योंकि हमारा मेहनती काम है, मेहनत पूरी है, मार्जिन नहीं है।
तो साफ दिए या शॉर्ट लागे झंडी झाड़ू दी उठ तबड़े खाए तो उनका दाल मुझे वाटू ना को दुए मोजे ने लिए तो मेरे घरे रोजी आवे मेरे घरे सुनी आवे चंड बात है चालू ही पहुँच कर दारा तो ना तुम्हें बुरा नहीं कहीं ना तब नौ सौ रुपये दे तेरे कहीं ना पसे मावसी जी भी तेरी बबे ने बोला तेरी बुढ़े बुमो जाएगी मुझे मैं पढ़ खा लूँ तो मुड़न बहुत खा लूँ बिल्कुल प्यास तक हूँ तेरी बबे बुमो उड़ा लियो मैं खराब की तुम्हारे तो बंद नहीं जीत कर बड़ी बात है दारे दारे बुढ़े दारे आदमी ये बुढ़े जानू नहीं
Thank you. नहीं मार पाओ ना जा साजन बंगा बंगी जाओ मार जा साजन बंगी नहीं ना बंगी पाल बंगी के ना एक आयो भाई बील आय अगती उगनाय बाद के जाना है जाने बाद ये गम है वो उन्हें अगती तो उन्हें के बार आय के बील ना ना बंगी मार बंगी मार तीन साल मार बंगी मार बील मंत्र में
Okay, let's stop that. Navroze, can you come up?
Yeah.
So what did you think? Let's have a little conversation about what you saw, because this is really the embedded kinds of belief systems and... where's Navroze? Please come. No, Aoji. Aoji. That we... You can bring in the... in because you made the film. Do chair. Yeah, so any questions in relation to the footage and some of the things that I might have said earlier? Any things that come to mind? Otherwise, yeah. Just the first episode, So the Banjara is still, well, this Banjara community, this family, I guess, Gopal Banjara, is eking out a living, as you can see. It's a hard life, it's a family. They are still working with this particular broom, this particular material, not working out too well. Other communities in the film, when we get to see maybe the Bargunda and they are more entrepreneurial, and they've made a shift because they're seeing this broom is not selling anymore, there's no market for it, so why continue? But then how one negotiates that access to material, because even in this little thing, how they have to contract, no? There's a contract of a certain, whether you're dealing with the Bargunda community who need the khajur broom, they have to pay some kind of money, no? And
each community where they get their material from, there's a whole chain of money that they have to give, including where they sit and make, do the work, yeah, for the space. So that is the last part of it, you know.
Yeah.
They have to, it is a...
There's a chain of, you know, middlemen and things. Yeah.
The mobility, if you like, I mean...
Please,
it's on.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I'm just saying that the mobility that you associate with the Banjara community is also one that you tend to associate with the ethics of the broom.
Yes.
I mean, the broom as something.
See, but if you follow what he was saying, I mean, you still hear new things. I mean, I've seen this film quite a number of times, and I must say, I keep learning it new things every single time. Because he says they were doing other things, like they were making combs, you know? Huh? They sang. Well, that singing itself, he says, more like a Gopal Banjara personal.
Yeah, he's a bhajan singer on the side, you know?
Making out, it's not like a caste profession or anything, but it was, I thought that kind, that's what oral. The narrative does, when he brings in suddenly out of the blue, and which is something academic discourse finds a hard time really structuring, because when we speak, why should he suddenly go into this memory of last night? I've been singing there for 10 days, singing bhajans, and all they give me is a little tilak and that's it. And you see that expression on his face, it sums it up, you know. So that's the power of the cinema.
And the daughter at the back laughs also.
Yeah.
Because they are the ones who are suffering, that he was not here for 10 days.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
She has a big laugh about it.
Yeah.
That her father goes to sing like this and comes
what
back.
What does he come back with? Kya milte? Kuch nahi. Yep, please.
We don't hear your questions. What kind of questions are they to ask?
Well, I tell you that in documentary filmmaking today, there are three or four things that we do,
which is now. We consider them very old-fashioned. Like, for example, there is no commentary. and all the catalysts of the film are the people whom you see. And all the arguments, political arguments or anthropological arguments, come from their own mouth, you know. So we, of course, the thing is that this was not done in one day. I mean, Rustom had done so much. Let me tell you how I got into this, because he has spoken about the museum. I know Komalji, Komal Kothari, since 1970, because I made my first feature film in my career in Rajasthan, where he was a very key person. And Rustom, when he started working with Komalji, he one day out of the blue called me and said, look, we are doing this museum and we need photographs. So would you like to come and take, we have no money. We would like to take some photographs, because of course in the museum you do need photographs and visual documentation at all. I took the first train from here and went to Jodhpur. We made several trips over there. So all the pictures that you see, all the photo, if you see that museum, all the photographs that you see are mine. And I must say, in this film, it was made a little easier because they had already done the research. Anyway, for the film research, we had to redo research. So for 3 months, we were traveling in all over Rajasthan, and we traveled about 5,000 kilometers before we took even the first shot. So just the way that you make a feature film and you do casting, you know, like who is going to play this role, who is going to play that role. Casting is as important in documentary films as it is in any other film.
And sometimes it's very tough, because like when in our earlier thing, we had an excellent, excellent interaction with a Dalit woman, Harijan woman, excellent. The defiance of the voice was something unbelievable.
Yeah.
When you went back to track her down and saying, would you like to talk to us again? No, she was not ready to talk. Or for that matter, that wonderful fellow, Solanki, at the end, who gives this unbelievable, let them see the Barugunda, because the irreverence of that, he takes on everybody, the government and the municipal sweepers, and he gives such galis to all of them. And yet, apparently, when you all went back, he was not ready. It was a different Solanki whom you met. Do you think we could show the Bargunda section get a sense, and then the Solanki section?
Yeah.
Could you guide them as to where?
So the thing is that the first interview that you heard is 3 hours long, but in the film it is only 4 minutes. So you keep talking to them and you keep making conversation with them, and then, as Rustom said, that we cut it on the editing table. So the process was that Rustom was not on the shoot, but we were talking with each other all the time. And he met us in the beginning, he met us in the middle, and then, of course, he came a lot of times for editing and subtitles, and, you know, before the film was finished. So that is the time when we were also discussing what we are asking, what is the concept, how you should guide them. Of course, we are listening, but we have to also guide them into, you know, he can't start talking about, for example, Indian Railways, when we are asking him about brooms and the caste and, you know, stuff like that. So there is a slight guidance that you have to give, but not really impose yourself on them or anything. Yeah.
Let's watch the two sequences, because this is more about that embedded habitus, and that kind of the belief system.
Can we please switch this off, because this is a very bad screen?
Yeah, please.
And the format is also
Bolo,
not correct.
Please ask. While we prepare, could you just go on to the Bargunda section?
The girls.
The girls, and then following up with that confrontation.
Because, you know, you talk about listening. You speak about listening with the body or the gestures, what the person is saying. And I'm wondering how Navroze, when you go into the field to make the film, how this listening and seeing come together? Because this is, I mean, what I find very interesting is that, you know, there's something that you conceptualize. How do you do that together?
Well, I think that I'll tell you one other thing, that when we go, we are full of equipment, which is very intimidating. You know, I've got a big camera, we've got this sound.
Yeah, you want to have a
fast forward. Go there, people, don't start talking to them.
We sit
there, we party with them for a couple of days, and when they are in the
country,
we let them see through the camera what's happening. We let them hear
This is the Barbunda family, and we just follow the sequence at the complex Khejur group. Okay. It's a forest, and of course they're taking the materials, and there's a conflict because they're encroaching on the territory of the Barbunda. That's the situation.
इसीलिए मम्मी पापा ने स्कूल ही नहीं भेजा काम करने के लिए, तो फिर इसका दिमाग काम ही रह गया कि आप उनको बच्चे फिर हम और सिखाएंगे या नहीं सिखाएंगे, उसको भी स्कूल भेजेंगे या कुछ भी धंधा दूसरा करेंगे। इस धंधे में हमारा कोई फायदा नहीं हुआ, सारे हमारे दादा दादी सब ये धंधा करके आए कि हम भी चाहते हैं कि अभी इसमें बहुत मेहनत लगती है, पैसा कम देते हैं, तो हमारे बच्चे को क्या हम ये काम नहीं सिखाएंगे।
छोटे की जब मांगने की है इसे मांग के लिए काम करती खाती मांग कर घरों में फिर रोटी का मांग के लिए बनाती, लेकिन अभी नहीं देते, अभी बोलते हैं काम करो दूसरा काम करो, लेकिन दूसरा काम मेरा कोई करने ही नहीं देता है, सिर्फ ये काम करते
आते ही नहीं है दूसरा काम हमारे लोग क्या करते हैं, हमारा कोई जमीन नहीं है खेत भी नहीं कोई नहीं देता, हमारे को बोलता है कोई जमीन खरीदेंगे तो बोलेंगे पाँच लाख दस लाख वो इतना पैसा हम कहाँ से कमा कर लाएंगे, और जो कोई गरीब देता है जमीन देता है सस्ता गरीब तो कोई भी चमार वो हमारा जमीन नाम में नहीं होती, बोलते हैं सरकार में तुम्हारा लिस्ट में बहुत बड़ा नाम है चार रूम की या ठाकुरों की ये जमीन हमारा नाम होती है, तो हम कैसे ले पाएंगे, चार ठाकुरों तो और ज़्यादा लेते हैं और देते थोड़ क्या जमीन हमारे गरीब देते हैं तो उस हमारे नाम में नहीं होती है जमीन, हम लोग तो बहुत परेशान हैं इतना भी जमीन नहीं है हमारे कमा खाने की वो भी जमीन नहीं है, हम ये सुखाने की बहुत जमीन चाहिए हमारे बाहर, इसको सुखाते हैं बनाते हैं काटा बहुत होता है, तो गांव के लोग तो फिर बोलेंगे कि तुम एक साइड में रहो क्योंकि इसका काटा बहुत होते हैं, तो लोगों के भाग जाता है काटा लग जाता है इसीलिए प्रॉब्लम है, हम गाँव में नहीं बाहर रहते
बोलते हैं कि तुम गंदे लोग हो इसीलिए बाहर रहो गरीब हो तुम बोलते अच्छे नहीं हो ऐसे करते हो, इस पहले जो सरपंच बना था ना इसके बारे में वो लगाया गया उसका पानी आता है मेरे उसके बाद तब सरपंच बनते हैं कुछ नहीं करते घर को और आते हैं शाम सुथरा उसके घर को ही बहुत
उसका घर बना दे
उसके बच्चे बच्चे को स्कूल खरीदाते हैं अच्छा कपड़ा पहनाते हैं अच्छा खिलाते हो, हम बोलते हैं मेरा भी कुछ का घूमे खाएंगे पर बोलते जब बोलते ना मेरे को फिर पूरी जीप भर कर आ जाते हैं क्या क्या मिठाई लेकर उस टाइम पे लाडू चिक्की जलेबी ये ला के देते हाँ थोड़ा दो तीन डब्बा दो तीन ला के बोलते हैं हाथ जोड़ के हमें भी देना हम तो बोलते हैं हम जीते हैं हम बहुत अच्छे करेंगे कमरा बनाएंगे क्या क्या करेंगे, तो फिर ये तो जाकर वोट दे देते हैं फिर कुछ नहीं
करते हैं हैंडपम्प खराब हो गया उसका भी ठीक नहीं करा है, बोलते हम कि वो पिन पे हमारा दान मिलता है ये मिलता है वो तो दिलाओ हमारे को, तो कोई सुन ही नहीं देता है, जाते हैं खाते हैं ऐसे करते हैं उसको पैसे मिलते हैं हमारा तो वही खाते हैं
एक दो बार बच गए हमारे यहाँ इधर सोई पर काम ही उधर हमारा बराती का एक दो साल पहले लड़का जुम्मन लड़का जो जाग के हम चाय वाला को बोल के डायरेक्ट मटका के चाल गए हाथ, उसको बोला तुम बोले हम जाती तो छुपाइया नहीं आती वो बोला डायरेक्ट हम बात ही वहाँ उधर रन सन बोलियो मां बना तक बोलियो वह मटका लेन पे इसका मटका का सोई पर दे वहाँ उधर कोई मान लो तो थोड़ा मन बदली की बात करती हो मन वो रेल फोड़ दे तो मेरे को उस गांव के इस एरे से उस गांव पहले नाके तक मेरे को पैदल चलना पड़ा क्योंकि मोटरसाइकिल देख के वहां उस एरिया के उनको नहीं निकल दे मेरे समाज कितनी होगी, मैंने मेरे गांव वाला मुझे मेरे समाज वाला कह दिया कि तेरे पास में मोटरसाइकिल है तू इस रोड के ऊपर बैठ के गांव के बाजार में नहीं निकल रहा, मैं कोई कारण कही है कैसा आप इस गांव में मोटरसाइकिल बैठ पर साइकिल बैठ नहीं चालू होता आप आना ये बात बहुत बड़ी न्याय है, तो मैंने भी साथ ऐसे किया मैं उस गाड़ी को लेकर के पैदल पैदल जा रहा था तो उस गाँव में बुजुर्ग बीच आदमी बीच में चाय के ऑटो पर बैठा हुआ था कि भाई साहब क्या मैं देखो ऐसा कर तो मुझे भाग दिया मेरा मतलब तो मेरी गाड़ी का ऊपर खुला पार कर बैठा हुआ अब पहले उनको कह देता हूँ मैं गाँव को मेरे इतना डर है साहब और जिस गांव में जाता हूँ जिस होटल में जाता हूँ पहले मेरे को कहते थे वो मुझे लोटा देकर मैं कहता हूँ मैं जाते से पागल हूँ अगर लोटा लेने के बाद अगर मेरे को कुछ भी तू शब्द कहते हुए तो मेरा बिल्कुल हराम हो गया तो इसलिए मैं एक अगर कैसा गाँव में तो कैसा रहता हूँ सामने जैसे मैं मिल गया अब बड़ा की चीज़ पर बाकी का जो फिर दिमाग को घुमा कर फिर बात बचा इसको इन विचार के ऊपर लाता हमारा दिमाग हमारे बरादरी में एक तो अकेला नहीं पहला नंबर तो यही कि एकता नहीं मैं पांच काम एकता बनाने वाला तो दस काम मेरे को सीधा करेगा वापस क्यों फूट गई होगी जात तो जो हमारी जात का एक मुद्दा हो जाता है ना जैसे गुजर गया ना जैसे गुजर गया ऐसे हम भी जांच की तरफ हमें बरादरी में अकेला नहीं गवर्नमेंट क्यों नहीं सुनेगा हमें भी सुनेगा कोई मैं कोई इंसान नहीं कोई मैं कोई कोई जानवर हूँ
ये हमारा समाज है बरमुंडा समाज जो मध्य प्रदेश से आए हुए मन तो ये है तो पहले ये हमारे समाज बनाती थी और अब क्या है कि कई समाज बनाने लगते हैं परेशानी ये है कि अब जहाँ हम जाते हैं दरकत लेने वहाँ हम खरीदते हैं खासदारों से सरकार से उन सरकार से एजुकेशन डिपार्टमेंट से उन उनसे लेते हैं तो हमारा हम देते हैं हजार रुपये वो 5,000 लगा के नहीं वहीं मांग खाते हैं बाकी लोग मुसीबतें का सामना करके ये लाते हैं तो गांव वाले हमारा सपोर्ट देते हैं तब हम थोड़ा गढ़ जीत जाते हैं बाकी हमको तो कभी भी मार सकते हैं बाबू को क्योंकि इनकी इज्जत का वो है ही नहीं ये जो चीज़ है अगर हमारे जाने तो उनको पैसे लगाने पड़ते हैं अगर हम नहीं जा रहे तो वो बिगड़ पैसे से काट सकते हैं क्योंकि एक गाँव में राजा एक ही रहेगा तो न्याय एक ही हिसाब से करेगा दो वो अलग उसके घेरेगा उसका वो
हम भी पहले खजूर निकलते थे तो उसमें भी हमको वही पर रोटी रोजी मिलती थी जो अब मिल रही है मगर क्या हुआ कि खजूर अगर कम पड़ गया क्योंकि दूसरे समाज वाले देखती है वो लोग है बाद भी वो क्या कर जंगल में वो पड़ गए और हमारा वो मान मिल नहीं रहा क्योंकि वो उन्होंने मतलब आप कब्जे में कर लिया अब हमको अब रोटी और पेट के लिए तो काम करना ही पड़ेगा इसलिए हमने भूल झाड़ू को कर लिया काफी इस वक्त वर्तमान के अंदर हम भी नहीं कर रहे हैं ये जोधपुर के अंदर मोमंडल यानी मुसलमान किसी भी कायद का चल रहा है और आपको हर गली में मिलेगा
छोटे समाज तो इसी को वापस क्योंकि ये पानी में भी चलती धूल में भी चलती फूल झाड़ू तो सिर्फ परस के अलावा कहीं नहीं चलती फूल झाड़ू 2 महीने चलती है तो ये 4 महीने चलती सस्ता और अच्छा फूल झाड़ू एक ही पड़ती है 25 रुपये 30 रुपये 40 रुपये और ये 25 रुपये में 5 आती है
खजूर की तरह हमको ये माल भी मिलेगा फिर तो हम प्लास्टिक में अच्छा अगर जैसा पब्लिक तो इस्तेमाल करेगी उस चीज़ को लेंगे प्लास्टिक झाड़ू कर करके और प्लास्टिक झाड़ू जो औरतें निकाल दिए ना तो ये टेढ़ी हो जाती है ये ऐसा अंदर लो लगा होता है इसलिए इससे क्या है कि वो कचरा निकलता नहीं पहला सवाल तो ये और दूसरा सवाल ये है कि अगर कोई जानवर खाए या कोई घर के अंदर बच्चे भी क्या है कि हमारे वाले तोड़ के मुंह में डाल देते हैं तो इससे ये भी परेशानी है और दूसरी बात ये है कि जो बेचने के लिए जाते हैं तो उनको मालूम पड़ गया भाई ये झाड़ू में कड़कपन नहीं है जो कड़क तो होना चाहिए जैसे कड़क होना चाहिए और निकालेंगे अब औरतें के झाड़ू निकालती है ना तो उस टाइम क्या करती है जो लगाती है जो लगाने से क्या है कि तो वो झाड़ू एकदम तिरछा हो जाएगा अब ये अगर नम जाएगी तो उसके ऊपर जो लगेगा इसलिए अब ये तो हो गया मतलब 90% 80% दिमाग से बाहर मगर हमने सबसे पहले चीज ये देखा था कि भाई अगर ये मार्केट में चलेगी तो ये काम करेंगे मार्केट में नहीं चलेगी तो फिर सवाल ही नहीं करने का अब सबसे बढ़िया तो फैक्ट्री से माल आ रहा है और बिल्कुल रेडीमेड आ रहा है कि जही मतलब केवल मशीनों से बन रहा है तो मैं ये चाहूँगा कि शायद हमारे समाज के ऊपर बहुत प्रभाव पड़ेगा अब दूसरी बात ये है कि अगर उस फैक्ट्री के अंदर ही हमारे वाले कोई 1-2-4 लड़के लग जाते हैं या कोई लग जाते हैं तो शायद मेरे अंदाज से उसमें ये मालूम पड़ जाएगा कि यार इसको इस तरह बनाया जाए या इस तरह बनाया जाए ये माल इतना महंगा है कि जनरल नॉलेज मिल जाएगा तो ऐसा हम कोशिश करते हैं कि शायद मशीन कम पैसे मिल जाए या फैक्ट्री में हम भी खोल सके, ऐसी स्थिति फिर कोशिश कर सकते हैं।
धंधा भी कर रहे हैं, धंधा कर रहे हैं, पैसा हो तो धंधा बढ़ा है, इतनी धंधा कर रहे हैं हमारे पास पानी तो बोले।
So we're seeing different ambitions and different aspirations. On the one hand, not being able to move out of the trade, on the one hand, saying we will go where the market is determining the demand for the broom. And of course, there is this communal tension that's growing between the Bargunda and the Bagaria community. They're encroaching on each other's territories. There are a lot of things that come up, and Navroze is talking about what gets edited. There was one sequence where this man, Madanlal, the other guy, was talking about these Bagaria women in a very, sexist way. And he was saying, well, these women, they can do anything. They can tear their own blouses and then accuse us of raping them. And there was a little discussion, should we include it, should we not include it? And we decided, there was some divided opinion there. But these are the kinds of issues. So to get to your question, everything is constructed. The voice is constructed. Whether you're writing a book and I'm creating Komal Kothari's voice, it is constructed every step of the way. You know, what one listens and what ultimately appears in the page, there is no, as I said, direct transference. Here in cinema, I think it's much harder to actually see that, especially if it's coming out of the mouth, as it were. But of course, it's heavily edited. And in every step of the way, there is a kind of conceptualization at work. So indeed, to make a broader analysis, you'd have to see all the 40 or 50 hours of footage and then arrive. But were there any broader questions that you wanted to ask me? Yep.
The same question I was asking you. When, in fact, we saw the story with yesterday.
Achha.
We were discussing it with Rajasthan. I find that when we read Rajasthan, what happens there is that there are these, little moments where one pauses and reflects on what one is reading.
Yeah.
Because you have little passages that talk about what did you hear, what did you mean to
It's reflexive. It's very reflexive quality. Yeah.
Whereas here, I was wondering what made both of you decide that you keep away from
that's Navroze, I think you have to answer that question because
question that you want to ask.
I think we should leave it for some other time when we are going to do just a film bit.
Yeah, you have to see the whole film maybe, but
yeah.
It is a distinction that actually for me the orality of the book frankly was flat as a stale dosa or whatever you want to call it for about 2.5 years. And I really didn't think it was a book. I really didn't think I had a book. Because all I was concentrating on was, quote, his voice, which of course I was reconstructing, you know. And I said, there's no life in it, there's no energy in it, there's nothing, there's no color in it. And he told me, I said, Komala, you don't use any adjectives. He said, I hate adjectives. So I said, well, that's a clue I've got to be honest about. And my editor was saying, dress it up. Like, write it up. This is what it's often. I said, I can't write it up. I've got to be as accurate as I can to what he's saying. And even as I'm realizing that he's a plain speaking man, I've got to get that voice, you know? And so that was really very tough, how to get that voice. And then I was talking to friends, I said, it's not working out. And they said, but you know, when you're talking about it, it seems to be a very lively book. And then I realized I had to bring my voice into the narrative very urgently. So what appears is this sort of jugalbandi in the book between sort of my voice and his voice, which are both constructed by me. I mean, and there's a third voice in the book, which is not, and that's the notes. Because everything, there are many things. Look, oral history is not going to give you everything. There are gaps, there are all kinds of blunders I've covered up many times here. Sometimes he won't complete the thought. I know he knows the thought. But I know that I can't go dot, 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 dot because the reader will not know it. Then you have to find, the note becomes very important. Kadin system, turn to people, science, and technology. They have a more technical knowledge of the Kadin, which he knows. It's not that he's, you know, ignorant of that, but it didn't come through in what he was saying, you know? So I feel there are three voices in the book, actually. There's his voice constructed, there's my voice in the sort of the jugalbandi, the urban voice, saying, what is this? Is this making sense? Can we talk about sati like this? Is it possible, et cetera, et cetera? And there are the notes, which are completely academic. And I think the notes are hugely important, and that goes back to the larger academic principle that we all know, that you cannot privilege the oral over the written. They actually have to work in a very complex kind of dynamic to rectify. So for example, when he talked about Ramdev, not the television Ramdev that we are talking about, the Ramdev who is the folk deity of Rajasthan, who's also known as Ramsha Peer, okay? So he's both, now this is a huge history that comes from, you know, Uch Baluchistan, it comes into Rajasthan through 14th century Ismaili missionaries who come and sort of don't proselytize directly, but kind of bury themselves within the practices of the Meghwal community and other such communities dealing with animals, and they convert from within. Now, this has been marvelously studied by this great writer whom should be in Indian academia, and that's Dominic Silla Khan, and she's an authority in this. And I realized that Komala didn't know this history because his informants didn't have that Ismaili background. So actually, it's a three-way dialogue, actually, in that chapter, because Dominic Silla Khan is as important as Komal Kothari in that dialogue. And you can't read that chapter successfully, I feel, if you don't bring in her knowledge, which is enormous, of this particular tradition. But he has the last word, and he says, isme bahut jhamela hai, he said. He says, there's too many complications here. And then he said something beautiful. He said, at some point, we have to let the secrets alone. And that, I think, could be read philosophically. It could be read, I mean, any thinker can build on that and say, leave the secrets alone. Don't open everything. He wasn't judging Dominic or any. He didn't have those kind of problems. But it's just that, yeah, this is a problem. Yeah.
You felt the book won't work or doesn't work until you inserted your How did you come to that conclusion?
I came to the conclusion because it became a more of a lively read. For some reason, when I was reading just his sections, you know, without the interpolations, somehow I felt it was too flat. It was just, and I don't know, that's a very interesting technical question, because mind you, the jugalbandi sections were written in 3 or 4 days. For me, I knew the material, so for me, writing that was just nothing, you know, but I just wanted to keep, quote, my voice. And the moment that voice came in, and it's very judicious, it's not pages, it's just 2 paragraphs, 3 paragraphs, just like sometimes, sometimes an edit, sometimes very strategic, you know, like it was also a structuring device, you know. So he'll say, you're talking about food, I like this cut. And he was saying, you know, in my family, we buy all the grain for the entire year. So I'm listening and I'm sort of going, and then I can't help asking, but you know, if you buy the grain for the entire year, there are 2 assumptions here. One, you've got money to buy grain for the entire year. Number 2, you have storage space. And he took it in his stride. It wasn't like I was trying to critique him or anything. He said, you are right. We are not nomads who represent a throwaway culture. And then he went into nomadism. You know, that I found very, very interesting, how the mind picks up the connection that is thrown and then goes somewhere else. So I felt that my insertion there was useful in terms of keeping the flow going. And there was one, I mean, miraculous moment when I was talking on Babuji, working on Babuji and reading John Smith at the same time. I was reading my sources simultaneously as I was listening to him. So that is an interesting thing. I did not come into the field, unlike Navroze, who had some kind of background. I have no background in Rajasthan. Believe me, I'm no folklorist. I have written a book on the politics of cultural practice, and I said, I'm tired of this theory stuff. I want to get real. I want to know something about what is really going on. Who better to talk to than this man? That's it. No, I had not done my readings as such in Rajasthan. Now that opens two sets of questions. One is, one line will say, how can you have a conversation in an academic anthropology if you haven't prepared yourself for the question? You know, you have to be informed. That's a very valid question.
But I don't buy it.
You don't buy that. I really didn't have, I think I heard the first session of my voice, I said, I'm so stupid, I'm asking stupid questions, you know, shut up, you know, and just listen. Because I didn't know that. But so the knowledge is very, you know, it's growing as it's emerging. You know what I mean? It's not, but maybe if I were talking to an academic, I really wanted to do a book on Ram Bhagat, this great historian. I really wanted to do that book, and I'm very sad it didn't happen because he passed away. He was also ill towards the end of his life. I've never known another person like that who could talk like, but on history, Ambedkar, Phule, Gandhi, I mean, what couldn't I have learned from that? I'm so stupid I didn't do it. And, but if I had gone to Ram Bhagat, I don't believe I could have been quite such an open book, because Gandhi, I can't not know something about Gandhi. I can't not know something about Jyoti Bhagat. I would still be in the listening mode, but I would have to have a different preparation. This was a unique situation, I would say. So, any questions from students? Are your students here?
No, we work with
you. Oh, yes, sorry, you're from Shrishti. You're let come to the museum. One team of you.
No,
yeah.
No,
yeah.
I have a question,
but I want to share.
Yeah.
Many years ago, while I was teaching at JNU, I was teaching a course to my MPhil students.
Uh-huh.
And that course was all about how would social scientists, but largely political scientists,
uh-huh,
deal with the theme of humiliation or indignities.
Right.
And so we are dealing with all kinds of things, including interviews which I did with some of the Dalit students of the university about their memories of their childhood and stuff like that. And I was always has this dilemma that how many questions I would put in and how many, what is the narrative that is emerging out of it?
Yeah.
How much of me
yeah.
is present in that and so on. It so happened that at the same time while I was writing it up, I met Pierre Bourdieu in Paris.
Wow.
And it was a chance that he has finished his book called The La Misère du Monde.
Yes.
And that's the fact book with a lot of interviews.
Yes.
I met him and asked him, I said, I have this dilemma, I'm doing this, I'm just writing up. He said, I'm asking too many questions?
Uh-huh.
Why not? So
yeah.
he gave me the example. He said, look, I'm interviewing these guys who are in the hospital. And the guy is describing his physical situation.
Uh-huh.
But sometimes he found, I said, are you feeling like this? The guy said, yeah, he just lights up.
Mm-hmm.
He said, that means, you know, he just tells me that, look, that means you are not actually only listening.
Yeah, you're interpreting.
You are having a dialogue.
Absolutely.
I said, I have a conversation.
Yeah.
I said, if you have a conversation, you have every right to say things.
Yeah.
He told me.
Yeah.
Earlier I was a bit diffident.
Yeah.
Earlier I was saying, should I say things or not?
Yeah.
Should I comment on what I'm feeling?
I think you're right.
So that's very interesting, how you're saying the
process. It changed, but you see, if you read the book towards the end, I couldn't sustain this more. Like the last two chapters is on basically on internationalism, globalization, which is an area of mine, this is my area. I couldn't keep this mode. It's interesting, I couldn't adopt the same listening mode or register for the last two chapters. So it becomes more of an interview mode with less interpolation. That's an interesting thing, and it could be linked to the fact that because I was a little more informed about, you know, what happens when you take folk performers and they go to Paris, and you know, which is what he had facilitated in a very strategic way. I could not be, you know, I had to intervene there and ask certain questions which I already knew were a problem. Like, what happens to folk performers when they return to their villages? What kinds of social disjunctions exist? And I could have taken it much further as I have, and I've dealt with, say, Arjuna Bhadurai's reading of habitus, which I find very postmodern and very cosmopolitan in its mediation, his interpretation being that when you become mobile and you travel from one place, your habitus becomes a little more loose, and I'm seeing the opposite in what is happening with the Langas and the Manganiyas, that the habitus is actually hardening. And what was, or maybe a habitus is being invented, so what were very loose practices in relation to Muslim practices, Islam, have now hardened, which, you know, they are no longer, that same fluidity is no longer there. And of course, there are all kinds of political factors which have to be taken into account. And nothing has changed in terms of their engagement with local social structures and organizations to arbitrate conflicts and all those, and those remain as strong as ever. So I, you know, those things become, I had to, yeah, please.
Yeah, so one takeaway for me.
Yeah, two, there's one more there, then we did, yeah.
So one takeaway for me,
yeah,
is this whole bit about construction that you said,
yeah,
and you said every inch of the way is
constructed. Yes, constructed.
Because even if you're listening a lot, you know, interventions are very few.
Yeah.
Ultimately, when you put it in the form of a book,
yes,
it all depends on how you place things.
Absolutely.
Placement is your agency.
Yes,
right?
Absolutely.
It's basically a factor of your agency.
But, you know, it's
a very important way.
Because I think this is one mold about academic work.
Yeah.
So you it is almost co-constructed.
It is co-constructed.
It's not something that you know I construct completely.
No, you can't.
Of course, it's co-constructed.
There is a complicity, as I said, between the list. There's a huge understanding, and that can get complicated. In this case, we didn't have a very complicated relationship as at a very personal level. It was. There was an ease in our relationship. I didn't have to see him as a guru or anything like that. He never spoke down to me, never once. He never spoke down to anybody. He didn't, and therefore you could ask him anything. You could ask him any question, whether you were a big university anthropologist or you were an ordinary person, you could ask him a question. I don't believe he changed his mode of address very significantly. You know, he might add a few details. So he never made me feel I'm ignorant. You know, that I don't know. You know, maybe today it would be more difficult. Today it would be probably our relationship would, I don't know how I would negotiate that relationship today. I would have to be honest about that. But you know, that is a speculative kind of thing. Yes, you had a question.
Yeah. Thank you very much for your engaging talk. This is a quick comment on. The phrase that I grew up with, I come from Tamil Nadu,
yeah.
My mom would say, "Thodako kattiyale adipen." It means, I'll hit you with a broomstick.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And I had this, when we saw the first clip and she was saying that, we don't hit with a broomstick.
Yeah, broomstick.
So that was a kind of different...
Yes, it's a different nuance. Not a different nuance, it's a different bit. It's, you know, if one really had to expand the knowledge of the broom, on this little section of Rajasthan on an all-Indian basis, it's a massive undertaking. I think it's like it's a big project. And you need a lot of local knowledge like the kind that you have just provided, because it is through such memories of being bit where, and let me say, even within Rajasthan, there's no stability in what we are hearing. Like, do you cross the broom, do you not do the hazard? We met for the longest time, vertical, horizontal, what is auspicious, what is not auspicious. We said, ultimately, come on, it's just going to be a lot more personally interpreted, and you know. And we don't have to put too many meanings into everything, you know. Perhaps, you know, that's our problem. We sort of anthropologize the material, and we want fixed meanings, and I think that it's probably more fluid in what works for them. And I can only say that the film has been made, it's a great record of this time. If the film had to be made in 15 years again, it would be a very different scenario. But let me end on a hope for good and just end on this. Whoever we talk to, and I think Navroze will endorse it, they have faith in the room. There's a lot of faith, regardless of trials and tribulations and how we serve. This is going to survive. You know, so maybe Ahmadi has got it right, I don't know, but it's like, I mean, this is not going to go away. And they're not afraid of the competition. They're not afraid of any, they're not like being wiped out. Many people say, oh, they're not wiped out. They're very, oddly proud of what they're doing, even while they're saying, this is a very hard life that we're living and we want to live. Thank you. There's some books here, very few, there are two copies, and there's some copies of Jhadu Katha.